right, friends, we have an exciting study today. I've entitled it God's End Time Prayer to Revive His Ordained Movement. And how many of you have the belief that you need a personal revival in your experience with Christ? Every day we need to walk nearer and closer to Him. And there's a lot of people asking the question today, why hasn't Jesus come yet? How many of you have asked yourself that question? Why is it that Jesus hasn't come? Why is it that we're still waiting after 150 years or so, after the close of the 2300-year time prophecy? Why are we still waiting? And I believe today we're going to find the answer to that question. So if you would, before we dive into our exciting study today, I just invite you to bow your heads wherever you are. We'll once again ask God's presence to be with us. Father in heaven, Lord, today we just ask that your Spirit would draw near to our hearts in a very special way. You would open our eyes to our own need. You would open our eyes to our need of Jesus, to our need to be close to Him and to draw close to you. And Lord, we just ask today that you would enlighten our eyes, give us truth, help us to see those things which you want us to see, help us to understand where the challenges really lie in our own hearts, and that you would draw close, you would open our ears, you would open our hearts, and that you would speak to us today through the power of your word. Help us to not be the same people when we leave and when we finish this study as before we began it. So we ask for your blessing, and we come in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, how many of you have ever had to really wait for something? How many of you have ever had that experience before? Something that you were really wanting or something that you were waiting to experience and you had to wait, wait, wait. Well, I remember the day that my wife and I were to get married. Even before I got married, there was a time when I was really pressing my wife. I said, "Dear, you know, I want us to get married." And she told me, she says, "I'm not quite ready." And I kept urging that and urging that, and I kept giving her the clue that I wanted to ask her to marry me very soon. And she flat out told me one day, she said, "If you ask me to marry you before I indicate that I'm ready," she says, "I can tell you, I will say no." And I thought, whoa, you know, I was like, well, I better make sure. So I just kept praying and kept courting her. And there was one day that she gave me this little heart. And she said, and it had a key size, a key shape cut out of it. And she said, and the heart said, "He who holds this key has, or he who holds the key has the key to my heart." And so she gave me the heart, and she kept the key. And she says, "When I give you the key, then you'll know that you can ask me, and I'll be ready." And several months went by, and one day she gave me this envelope, and it was quite thick. And I had this really long love note. You know how you do when you're courting. And it, in the very end, the very last page of that, she had the little key taped to the bottom at the end of that letter. And I didn't waste any time. The very next weekend, I asked her. I drove down. I lived 4 hours away up in Tennessee. I was working for a church there. And that very next weekend, I drove all the way down. And I took her father, her dad, my now father-in-law, out to breakfast. And I was going to ask his blessing. I was going to ask for her hand in marriage. And he knew why I had driven down. He knew that that's what I was going to do. And so we drove over there and we had breakfast, and I was getting nervous, you know. I was starting to sweat, and I thought, man, I said, well, I still got some time. I'm going to wait. So this was happening on the way over there. Then when we were eating lunch, I just couldn't muster up the courage to do it. And I was sweating and nervous, and I was just like, oh, Lord, how am I going to ever do this? What if he says no? Even though I knew he wouldn't say no, I still had that fear, you know. And so we're driving home, and we're about halfway home, and I still haven't asked him. And he's just making small talk, and about 10 minutes away from being at the house, he finally asked me. He says, "Well, isn't there something that you want to talk to me about? Isn't there something you want to ask me?" And I said, "Yes." I said, "I'd like to ask for your daughter's hand in marriage." And it was just so hard for me to blurt it out. And he put his hand out to shake my hand. He said, "Man, I thought you'd never ask." He said, "I'd be thrilled for you to be my son-in-law." And we've had a very good relationship ever since. Now, I remember the day of our wedding. I was waiting. And my wife, her hairdresser, she had her cousin do her hair. And she said to her cousin, she says, "I'm not really caring how you do my hair." She says, "But there's one thing that you cannot do to it." And I forget what it was, straighten it or something like that. You can't do certain thing to it. And she says, "Whatever you do, don't do that." And guess what she did, her cousin, he did. He did exactly what she told him not to do, right? And her hair kind of got really all frizzled and fried. And so the wedding got delayed. And so I'm actually standing out there in the front, and the pastor to marry us is there, my groomsmen, all the people are waiting. The wedding's supposed to start at 2:00, you see. And so we're waiting, and it's 2:10, and then it's 2:15, and then it's 2:20, and then it's 2:30. I'm thinking, man, maybe she used this as an excuse so that she could escape and have more time to get away because she decided she didn't want to get married. And I thought, man, maybe I'm going to live the rest of my life as a bachelor, right? But finally, after great patience and a long time of waiting, finally those doors opened, and there she was, beautiful as could be, looking like the bride of Christ, and I was satisfied, yes? You know, some things are worth waiting for. How many of you would agree with that today? And we are indeed in a waiting period when it comes to the second coming of our Lord. We have been waiting now anxiously for a very long time. And sometimes people are tempted to get frustrated and irritated. But God is telling us, we're going to see through the study, just where we're at and what God is waiting for. Could it be possible today, friends, that we are not waiting upon God as much as He is waiting upon us? Could that be a possibility, yes or no? I believe that it's not just a possibility. I believe that it is the truth. And we're going to see that in our study today. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to take three different groups. We're going to look today at first the 12 disciples and the experience that they went through. Then we're going to look at the Advent believers and the experience that they went through. And then we're going to look at our generation today, the Laodicean church. And we're going to see that God has took the first two groups through a process, through several steps, that we also, as the Laodicean church, must go through. Are you ready for this? Yes or no? All right. So here is one of the first things that the disciples experienced. In Luke chapter 24, if you turn in your Bibles there, Luke chapter 24, we're going to see a great disappointment that His people went through, His disciples went through after. This is after the time that Jesus was crucified. So Jesus had been crucified. He actually, at this point, had been resurrected. And now He was waiting to appear to His disciples. Now, these two disciples were walking upon the road called Emmaus, and they were talking to themselves. Notice verse 14. Luke chapter 24 and verse 14, it says, "And they talked together of all the things which had happened. And so it was that while they conversed and reasoned, that Jesus Himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were restrained so that they did not know Him. And He said to them, 'What kind of conversation is this that you have had with one another, and you walk and are sad?' Then one of those whose name was Cleopas answered and said to Him, 'Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem? And have you not known the things which happened there these days?' And He said to them, 'What things?' So He said to him, 'The things concerning Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how the chief priests and rulers delivered Him to be condemned to death and crucified Him.'" And notice verse 21, specifically what they say. "But we were hoping," we were what? "We were hoping," He said, "that it was He who was going to redeem Israel. Indeed, besides all this, today is the third day since these things had what? Had happened. Now, friends, was that a disappointment when the disciples saw Jesus die upon the cross? Was it a disappointment to them, yes or no? It was a terrible disappointment. They thought when they were on their way to Jerusalem, walking with Jesus on down into Jerusalem, they thought, man, now's the time. You read about it in the Gospels. Now's the time when Jesus is going to sit upon his throne and rule as king. Now's the time when he's going to drive out the Romans and he'll take his place, his rightful place as king and ruler over Israel. And we will be delivered from all this bondage. And the disciples talked amongst themselves and they said, who's going to be the greatest? Who's going to sit upon his right hand? Who's going to sit upon his left hand? And et cetera, et cetera, right? But when they got to Jerusalem, Jesus wasn't going there to take his place upon a throne. He was going there to take his place upon the cross. And redemption was brought to them, not deliverance from in the form of not being delivered from the Romans, but being delivered from their sins by him shedding his blood upon the cross for them. Can you say amen? But they couldn't see that. And so what was for them a ultimate disappointment, God wanted to turn into a divine appointment. Amen? Now, as Jesus continues to walk with these disciples and he continues to talk with them, the Bible tells us, we're not going to read all of it now, you can read it on your own, but the Bible tells us that he goes into the house with these disciples and their eyes are what? Their eyes are opened and they see Jesus for who he was. And when they see him, he disappears. They jump up, they run into the town and they tell some of the other believers, we have seen Jesus risen from the dead. Amen? So at that point, their disappointment turned into a divine what? Appointment. Now, all the disciples went through this. They went through this bitter, bitter disappointment. Don't forget that word, friends. Bitter. What is it? Bitter. Don't forget that word because that's going to appear multiple times in our study. So they went through this great disappointment, but it led to a divine appointment. Were they happy when they saw Jesus had risen from the dead? Yes or no? They were very happy. So then, after Jesus rose from the dead, after the bitter disappointment was turned into a divine appointment, then as Jesus stood with them for the final time before he ascended into heaven, they began asking him a particular question. Go with me now to the book of Acts, the book of Acts chapter 1. The book of Acts chapter 1, and we're going to see this played out. Acts chapter 1 and verse 6. Watch this. Even after the resurrection of Jesus, did they still know and understand everything? Yes or no? At that point, they still didn't, did they? Because they were kind of asking the same question that they were expecting before Jesus was crucified. Notice this, Acts chapter 1 and verse 6. It says, therefore, when they had come together, they asked him, saying, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? See, they were asking the same question even after he rose from the dead as they did before. They thought, oh, he's going to deliver us from the earthly kingdom. He's going to establish an earthly kingdom on this earth. But Jesus made it clear from the beginning that he came not to establish an earthly kingdom, but a spiritual kingdom. Amen? And eventually, there will be an earthly kingdom, but Christ must be enthroned in the heart of every human being first. Amen? So they were asking that question, Lord, will you now restore the time? And what is his response to them? He said to them, it is not for you to know times or seasons, but for the Father, which is put in his own authority. So what was Jesus saying? He's basically saying, no, I'm not going to restore the kingdom, but it's not for you to know when. It's for you to simply follow me and obey. Now, what were they missing? Notice what he says in verse 7 again. It is not for you to know the times or seasons. They were missing the bigger picture. Have they been truly converted yet? Yes or no? They had not fully experienced full conversion. They needed character, power, and the Holy Spirit to be poured out upon their hearts. Yes? And that's what they experience where and when? During the 10 days in the upper room. Are you with me? So they experienced a great disappointment. It was turned into a divine appointment when Jesus rose from the dead. They began asking Jesus then, this question is important, is it the time? Is it the time now to set up your kingdom on this earth? Jesus says, no, it's not time yet. You're missing the bigger what? You're missing the bigger picture, right? There's elements that are important to fall into place before my kingdom can be set up upon this earth. And friends, let me say before we even move on, that that's exactly the case with what's happening today. That's why there is a delay for Jesus to come, because there are certain elements that need to fall in place. And one of them is that His people in that day, the disciples, they needed Christ's character, power, and Holy Spirit to radically transform their lives and turn their characters into the image of Christ's character. And that's exactly what we need today. That's what we're going to see at the end. But we got a means to get there. We got a ways to go. Look also in verse 8. Notice what Jesus tells them. He says, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth, right? So Jesus not only said, He didn't just say, hey, you need my character, you need my spirit, but He said, you also need what? You also have, or rather, not you need, but you also have a mission to fulfill. Yes or no? Jesus says, you're not done yet. It's not time for me to set up my kingdom. You've got a work to do. Do God's people have a work to do today? Yes or no? Friends, there are souls perishing all around the world. God's people have a work to do to proclaim His character and His message to a dying world. But this is what Jesus... So Jesus is saying, before my kingdom can be established, this, 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 and this has to happen. Are we seeing it? Yes, we're seeing it. Now, there was also a waiting time that needed to take place before they would be ready. What does Jesus tell them? Drop down to verse 12. Isn't it amazing how it's all right here? Notice this, verse 12. It says, then they returned to Jerusalem. Now, this is after He said to them, you have a mission to fulfill. You'll go for me to Jerusalem and to all the world. You'll be witnesses for me. After that, in verses 9 through 11, Jesus then ascends up into heaven. He goes away. He goes up into the heavenly sanctuary to establish Himself as the high priest and to begin ministering on the behalf of humanity. Yes, that's what happens. Then in verse 12, this is where we talk about the waiting time. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey. And when they had entered, they went up into the upper room where they were staying, Peter, James, John, Andrew, Philip, and all the other guys. Verse 14, these all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with His brothers. So what happened when Jesus left? What happened after Jesus said, you have a mission to fulfill, you need to develop a character like mine? Jesus then went away to intercede for them. He didn't go away. He didn't leave them alone. He went away so that He could send His Spirit and be more effective, yes? More effective in working for them. Now He's interceding for them in heaven. What do? They go back to Jerusalem. They go up into the upper room and they play video games. Right? They go up into the upper room and they check Facebook. Is that what they did? Now, I'm not against Facebook. I have a Facebook, but I'm just teasing. They went up and they watched their favorite movie. Is that what they did in the upper room? It's not what they did in the upper room. What did they do? It says, the Bible tells us, that they made supplication and they had prayer and they were searching their hearts and they were pleading with God that He would pour out His Holy Spirit. This is what they were doing during the what, everyone? The waiting time. The what? The waiting time. Don't forget that, all right? Now, we get a picture, a beautiful picture from the book Acts of the Apostles of exactly what was specifically taking place up in that upper room. And we're going to see that here today. This is from page 37, and it says this: as the disciples waited for the fulfillment of the promise, they humbled their hearts in true repentance and confessed their unbelief. They reproached themselves for their misapprehension of the Savior. I mean, look at this, friends. This is incredible. It says that they humbled their hearts in true repentance and they confessed their sins. They went up into that room and they pled with all of their hearts to God that He would reveal to them the sin in their life and that He might give forgiveness and grace and forgive them for what they had done against their Savior. They reproached themselves for their misapprehension of the Savior. They remembered all the times in those 3.5 years that they walked with Jesus of the foolish things that they said. They remembered all the times when they sat and they talked about who would be the greatest. They sat and thought about all the times that Jesus spoke words of life and words of truth to them, and their hearts were turned off by that, or they were offended, or they were wounded, or they were hurt when Jesus spoke plainly and straightly to them. They remembered all the times that they had let Jesus down. They remembered all these things. But, oh friends, what a blessing that Jesus now had ascended, and He was now the high priest interceding on their behalf. Amen? And as that conviction of their sin was brought to their hearts, they confessed it with their mouth and with their hearts, and Jesus supplied the need for them to be forgiven. How many of you can say amen? Notice this, she continues, like a procession, scene after scene of His wonderful life passed before them. As they meditated upon His pure, holy life, they felt that no toil would be too hard, no sacrifice too great, if only they could bear witness in their lives to the loveliness of Christ's character. I mean, think about that for just a minute. They suddenly began to realize, and it began to hit them hard and heavy, just what they had in Jesus when He walked with them on this earth. They began to say, the Son of the living God had just spent 3.5 years with us. And look how we treated Him. We were fools. But thank God for His grace. And they began to realize the sacrifice that Jesus had made for them, that His righteousness was given to them, that His glory was revealed to their hearts, and they began to see Jesus like they had never seen Him before. And they said, oh man, everything about the life of Jesus was so amazing, so beautiful, so pure, so perfect. It was prophetic. Jesus fulfilled prophecy in His life. All these things that began to just hit them like 2x4s. And it radically broke and changed their hearts. They were radically changed, you understand, by those 10 days in the upper room of spending time in the presence of God, wrestling with God through prayer, confessing their sins, asking God to cleanse their hearts and renew them and give them a vivid picture of Jesus. As Jesus became more and more real to them, they suddenly realized that any sacrifice that we would have to make, whether it be our job, our lives, our family, even giving our death, whatever it is that God would call us to give to demonstrate to some other poor soul who didn't know Him. Whatever it is that God called us to do, it would never be too great a sacrifice. It would never be too great because of the great sacrifice that He had already given. Notice it says, as they meditated upon His pure, holy life, they felt that no toil would be too hard, no sacrifice too great, if only they were willing to give all, just so that some soul might know what they knew about the loveliness of Christ's character. Now think about that for just a minute. Sometimes people grumble when they're asked to do something in the church. Yes or no? Sometimes Jesus asks us to sacrifice some small thing, some small insignificant, a television show, some program, something that I like, because He wants us to do something for Him. He wants us to give some literature to some person, or whatever it may be anything. And how often do we grumble and we complain? But friends, when we see Jesus through the eyes of faith and we see what He has really done for us, and that really sinks into the soul and it radically changes our hearts, no toil will be too hard, no sacrifice too great, only if we can bear witness of His character. Amen? So during this waiting time, they experienced true surrender, yes? And the Bible tells us in Acts 1, verse 14, that they continued with one accord. One accord. The recognition of their mission, the recognition of their need for Christ and His character, their recognition of their need for the Holy Spirit, the recognition of their need for revival and a fresh experience with Christ, their recognition of these things brought them together as one, and Christ was then able to work through them. Can you say amen? The disciples prayed with intense earnestness for a fitness to meet men and in their daily intercourse to speak words that would lead sinners to Christ. Brothers and sisters, when was the last time that we prayed for an intense earnestness to meet men where they were and to lead them to Jesus? Let me tell you something today. Many times we pray about a lot of things, but I remember I've read stories about old pioneers and whatnot praying all night for some soul and seeing him being led to Christ. When was the last time we prayed for those souls? Notice this statement. This was a rebuke to me, especially after the background that I've had. Notice this, Acts the Apostles, page 37, putting away all differences, all desire for the supremacy, they came close together in Christian fellowship. Imagine that, friends. Imagine if that spirit could prevail in the church today. And let me tell you what, friends, lest any skeptical mind say that'll never happen, let me be the first to tell you that it will happen. It will happen even to a greater degree than it has happened in the past, because God tells us that His church will be revived. It will come back to life, and His Spirit will fill His church. It will fill His people. It will fill those hearts who are willing to be surrendered to Him. Those that are willing will be filled. The Bible tells us this. All desire for supremacy. Think about it, brothers and sisters. Nobody was arguing about who had the greatest position anymore. Nobody was arguing about who was the best. Nobody was arguing about who was the pastor's favorite. Nobody was arguing about who was asked to do this and who wasn't. But they all came together and they recognized that whether I'm asked to do something or not, whatever I can do to further the cause and the cause of Christ and His kingdom, that is what I am willing to do. How many of you today want to have that spirit in your hearts? How many of you today think that God's church needs to have this experience, amen? And it doesn't, revival doesn't start with God's church. It starts with your heart today. Revival starts with you. And then it spreads to others. And then the church will catch fire. Can you say amen? One interest prevailed. One object swallowed up all others. All hearts beat in harmony. The only ambition of the believers, watch this, friends, the only ambition of the believers was to reveal the likeness of Christ's character. That's all they cared about. And that's all that really mattered. When the church, when those individuals in the church, and I'm not attacking the church, I'm not attacking leadership, I support our church leadership, amen? I believe that God works through them, but I'm talking about us as a body of believers, as a group of as our denomination. I'm not attacking church leadership. I'm putting it all upon myself, and each one of us have to accept our own responsibility for this. But their only thing that mattered to them was revealing for Christ's character to the world and to labor for the enlargement of His kingdom. The multitude of them that believed were of one heart and one soul. Friends, when God's church becomes absorbed with two things, being like Christ and helping others to be like Christ, great revival would take place in the church. How many of you would agree? Friends, we today are so absorbed with the things of this world, it is unbelievable. And we are told that one thing ought to absorb our attention and nothing else, and that is the proclamation of the three angels' messages. That's what we're told. I would say two things, not just proclaiming it, but also living it. Amen? But you can't really proclaim it if you're not living it. No longer with a collection of independent units or of discordant and conflicting elements. No longer were their hopes set on worldly greatness. Think about that. Many times we're more absorbed with working that overtime to get that extra money, or this job that I have to do, or this thing that I want to do. We're more absorbed oftentimes with the things of this world that are totally and utterly unnecessary than we are the things of Christ. And brothers and sisters, no wonder we are asleep spiritually as a people of God. No wonder that we are weak in moral power and moral strength to resist the temptations of the enemy. No wonder our churches are dwindling in numbers, because we are more absorbed with the world and its greatness and its glamour and its glory and its entertainment than we are the spiritual things of God. That's a fact. It's just the reality. And that's why we're experiencing such weakness. They were of one accord, of one mind and one soul. Christ filled their thoughts. They were not consumed with building bigger houses. They were not consumed with more money in the bank account. They were consumed that precious souls might hear, know, and embrace Christ and His loveliness and His beauty, because it is Christ that brings true joy, contentment, and happiness to the soul. Can you say amen? The advancement of His kingdom was their aim. In mind and character, they had become like their master. They became like Him. And men took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. How many of you today, when you meet somebody on the street, that they would be able to tell that you have been with Jesus? How many of you would like people to know that about you? I would like people to know that. When I encounter people, when I speak with them, when I engage with them, when I leave, I don't want them to say, "Oh man, how wonderful and great Wes is." I want them to be able to say, "Man, there's a man that loves the Lord. There's a man who's sacrificed himself to Christ. There's a man who walks in the ways of Jesus." And I don't want them to say it to glorify me. I want them to say it because I want Christ's character to make an impact on their hearts. Amen? That's what I want. I want to be humble and meek like Jesus. And I want people to see Jesus in me. I don't want them to see any ounce of me, but only Christ. Only Christ. Well, what were the things that they went through? I took all the things that we just talked about and I put them in a list. And these are the things that we came up with. They humbled their hearts. They experienced true repentance. They confessed their unbelief. They reproached themselves for their misapprehension of the Savior. They prayed for a fitness to share Christ. We must be doing the same. They put away all differences and forgave each other and asked for forgiveness from God. They put away their desire for supremacy. They came close together in Christian fellowship. They had no more desire for worldly greatness. They were done with it. They didn't care how people viewed them. They didn't care if they were glamorous and glorious and high up above in the worldly honor. They just cared about what God thought about them. And Christ filled their thoughts. Imagine, brothers and sisters, if we have this experience today It could radically change our homes. It can radically change our church. And it can radically change the world. Amen? How many of you believe it today? I believe it. So the 12 disciples, when they had that experience of surrender, then the Bible tells us that the Holy Spirit came down with what? Power. It says that it came down like a mighty rushing wind, and it shook the whole building, and it filled their hearts. It filled their minds. It didn't just fill the room, friends, but it filled the people with the Spirit of God. And they went forth then to proclaim God's message of truth, His message of salvation. Christ Object Lesson says, with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. Friends, when we surrender our hearts to Christ, and when we experience revival and true radical change that only God can bring, then it gives us power in our lives to overcome temptation, and it also gives us power to proclaim that message to those around us. Amen? Sometimes I think that we're afraid to experience the power of God because we don't want to share our faith with others. And God will not pour out His Spirit on those who are not willing to share that message with someone else. It's not enough to just receive, brothers and sisters, but we must also what? We must also give. Amen? And then the mission was accomplished. Education, page 95, says, then there was such a revelation of the glory of Christ as had never been before witnessed by mortal man. By mortal man. Mission accomplished. Colossians 1:23, Paul said that they had preached the gospel to every creature under heaven. The gospel went to the whole world. Amen? Now look, friends, this is the experience that they had. These are the steps that they went through. Number one, they asked, is it what? Is it time? Lord, is it time for you to restore the kingdom? And what did Jesus say? He said, no. And even before this, they had experienced a great want, disappointment that turned into a divine appointment. Then God said, you're missing the bigger want, the bigger picture. You need my character. You need my spirit. You need my power. You need revival. And that's what they needed. And then they realized, once they went through that, they realized that there was a mission yet to fulfill. God had a work for them. Does He have a work for us today? He has a work for us today. But then before that time, there was a waiting time. There was a waiting time that they needed to go through and experience revival. During that waiting time, they went through true heart searching, and they pled with God that He would change their hearts. And when that happened, how long was that time period? It was 10 days, right? 10 days, and when that happened, the Spirit of God was poured out upon them. They preached the gospel into all the world, and then the mission was accomplished. How many of you can say amen to that? Yes? Praise the Lord for that. Now, notice what we're told in Colossians 1:21. Notice this. Not Colossians, but Christ Object Lessons. Sorry, C-O-L, and I thought it was Colossians. Christ Object Lessons, page 121. It says, these scenes are to be what? Repeated. And with what kind of power? Greater power. The outpouring of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost was the former rain, but the latter rain will be what? More abundant, she says. The Spirit awaits our demand and reception. Imagine that. The Spirit, God is waiting for His people to get serious with Him, and He's willing to pour out His Spirit to the same level that we're willing to receive it. If we're not very serious about receiving God's Spirit, if we're not serious about pleading and wrestling with Him and asking Him for it, He's not going to give it to us. If we plead a little bit, He'll give us a little bit. If we plead at a medium level, He'll give us a medium amount. But if we plead for the fullness, will He not give us the fullness? He'll give us the fullness. It's all about sincerity of heart, brothers and sisters. It's all about yielding the will to God and allowing Him to be in complete control of our lives. That's what God is looking for in His people. Christ is again to be revealed in His fullness by the Holy Spirit's power. So we're told that these scenes would be what, everyone? Repeated. Were they repeated again in history, yes or no? Yes, they were. We're going to Revelation chapter 10 now. We looked at Acts, we looked at the disciples, now we're going to Revelation chapter 10. Go with me there. And Revelation chapter 10, for those who may not know, Revelation chapter 10 deals with the prophetic Advent movement. It's in Revelation 10, this prophecy reveals the Advent movement of the 1800s. Look in verse 8. Look in verse 8. It says this, "Then the voice which I heard from heaven spoke to me again and said, Go take the little book which is open in the hand of the angel who stands on the sea and on the earth." Now, during this time, in the book of Revelation 10, I'm just going to give you a very quick background. This little book that is in the angel's hand, what book, does anyone know what book that is? It's the book of Daniel. And this book was once closed, the angel said, but there would come a time when it would be open, and that people would begin to study this book. And as they studied the book of Daniel, they would find that the prophecies written in the book of Daniel were at that time being fulfilled, you understand. And so Daniel, the time period when people began to study the book of Daniel and they began to study the prophecies in the book of Daniel were in the late 1700s and the early 1800s, okay? There were people who were looking and waiting for the second coming of Jesus, and they began to study. As they began to study, one of the main people that began to study the book of Daniel was a gentleman named William Miller. He was a Baptist preacher, or he actually was before that a skeptic of the Bible, and ultimately, because of his study of prophecy, he accepted the Scriptures as truth, and he started to believe in God, and then he started speaking in these Baptist churches, and then he began to, or his family had a Baptist background, but then he began to speak in churches all around, and thus began what was known as the Millerite movement. And as William Miller studied the prophecies of Daniel and also of Revelation, he believed that at the end of the 2300-year prophecy spoken of in Daniel 8:14, he believed that Christ would return in the year 1844. And he began to preach that, and many others around the world began to preach that message. Some people came to the conclusion, the same conclusion, about 1844 as William Miller did, and they never met William Miller. And they were preaching it in different parts of the world. And so this was definitely a God-inspired movement. And the Millerites, as they study these prophecies, they began to ask the question about the close of the 2300-year prophecy in 1844. They asked the question, is it what? Time. Isn't that interesting? They asked the same question that the disciples asked. Yes? Was it the time? Yes. It was the time, not for Jesus to come, but for Jesus to begin a new phase of his ministry in the final judgment. Yes? So when Jesus did not come in 1844, what did they experience? A bitter disappointment, yes? Look in verse 9 and 10. It says, "So I went to the angel and I said to him, Give me the little book. And he said to me, Take and eat it, and it will make your stomach bitter, but it will be as sweet as honey in your mouth. Then I took the little book out of the angel's hand and ate it, and it was as sweet as honey in my mouth. But when I had eaten it, my stomach became what? My stomach became bitter." They had a great disappointment that they went through just like the disciples. Yes or no? You know, many people say to me, how is it that the Adventist could have thought that Christ was coming in this year? And how is it that they could really be the true church if they went through such a great and bitter disappointment? I say, well, how is it that the disciples could have been God's true church in the days of the book of Acts when they went through a bitter disappointment? They all thought that Jesus was going to set up his kingdom. They all thought the prophecy said that he was going to deliver them from Rome. But he had another type of deliverance in mind, and they were bitterly disappointed. Our people went through the same experience as the disciples. which gives me the confidence to know that this is the right movement for the last days. How many of you can say amen? Thirdly, God revealed to them that they were missing the bigger picture. After the disappointment, notice in verse 11, he said to me, you must prophesy again about many people's nations, tongues, and kings. So they were missing the bigger picture. They needed Christ's character, the fullness of his character, the fullness of his power, because there was a great mission to fulfill. And that mission was to preach the first, second, third angel's message to the what? To the world, yes? And as they experienced the bitter disappointment, many of those people left the faith, didn't they? They left the faith. But the few that remained, the remnant, they came back and they began to study their Bibles and they began to pray and they began to see, as they studied Daniel again and again, they began to see that they were not wrong about the time of the prophecy, but they were wrong about which event it would be, correct? So as they began to study this, they began to see, oh man, we were actually right, not about the event, but about the time. And their divine disappointment, their great bitter disappointment turned into a divine appointment. Isn't God good at turning disappointment into appointments? He's good at doing that, isn't he? Now, after that disappointment, they had a waiting time in which they needed to develop a deeper character. Are you with me? And so the believers began to pray, and they began to restudy, and they began to regroup and reband after the disappointment. And once they did that, once there was this waiting time, this testing period, God always tests us because the devil is always accusing us. You understand? God's always accusing, or the devil's always accusing God, and the devil's always accusing us. And so God allows his people to go through tests to close the mouth of the devil. So the next time you have a bitter disappointment in your life, take it as an honor from God that he's allowing you to close down the arguments against the enemy. Amen? That's exactly what he's doing. So during this waiting time, as they studied, they had this character to develop. And God began to draw near to his people. Amen? And just like they had this waiting, the disciples had the waiting time of the 10 days, so the Advent believers had a waiting time to understand what God's real plan was. And during that waiting time, just like the disciples, they began to surrender and search their hearts. They began to ask God to give them characters like him. And a remnant was formed, yes? Now, watch this, friends. Once they gathered together and they were in unity, they were in one accord, their hearts were surrendered to Christ, and they were all unified, then the Holy Spirit, just like it came in the book of Acts, it came again to the Advent believers. It came down in the form of the visions and dreams of Ellen White. Amen? It happened. Revelation 12, 17, the testimony of Jesus was restored. The vision of prophecy, the gift of prophecy, was given back to God's remnant last day people because they were keeping the commandments of God and had the faith of Jesus. The scripture says that if the people of God do not keep his commandments, there are no visions from the Lord. And from the time of shortly after the early church, through the dark ages, all the way down to the end, there had been no gift of prophecy in the church because the people of God had not been keeping, the church had not been keeping his commandments. There were small pockets of people here and there. But finally, there was a group that would conform and merge together. And they began keeping God's commandments, and God restored the gift of prophecy. And the Holy Spirit came down on the Advent believers just like he had done in the book of Acts. How many of you can say amen to that? Praise the Lord. And then they began to realize that they had a larger mission than they could accomplish. And it would take the Spirit of God to help them proclaim this message in all the world. And they realized it's not time for Jesus to come. The end of the judgment time began in 1844, but we have a work to do. And thus the work of spreading the message launched and began. Amen? Now look, watch this. The disciples had the same experience as the Millerites. They asked, is it the time? Yes. They said they experienced a great disappointment. Jesus showed them that they were missing the bigger picture. Yes. They realized that there was a mission to fulfill. There was a waiting time. There was true searching of heart and revival. The Holy Spirit was poured out, and then the gospel was preached throughout the world. How many of you can see that process in both groups? Never believe that the Advent movement was not from God. Brothers and sisters, it was a divinely inspired prophetic movement. It was described in the book of Revelation. We are in God's true church in the last days. Can you say amen? We are His divinely ordained movement. That's the word I was looking for. Divinely ordained movement, and God will see His church and His people to the end. How many believe that? Now, there's one more group. There's one last piece to the puzzle. You remember the statement, Christ Object Lessons 121. She says, these scenes are to be what, everyone? Repeated. And with what kind of power? Greater power. The outpouring of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost was the former rain, but the latter rain will be more abundant. The Spirit awaits our demand and reception. Christ is again to be revealed in His fullness by the Holy Spirit's power. These scenes would be what, everyone? Repeated again, one more time. Well, what about this day and age? What about this time period? Turn with me in your Bibles to the book of 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter chapter 3. And we're going to see, I believe, a passage of Scripture in the book of Peter that directly speaks to the times in which we live. Directly. And so 2 Peter chapter 3, we're going to see this very, very powerfully. All right, 2 Peter 3. Adventists, if you ever consider, Adventists are always asking, is it the time? Yes or no? We're always thinking, now's the time Jesus is going to come, right? He's going to come. All the signs are being fulfilled. And we keep watching, we keep waiting. And we have been preaching the signs of the times over and over and over again, have we not? Look in verse 1 and 2. Peter says, beloved, I now write to you this second epistle, and I stir up your minds by way of reminder, that you may be mindful of the words which are spoken by the holy prophets and the commandment of us, the apostles of our Lord and Savior. So have Adventists been mindful of the words of prophecy, yes or no? Oh, yes. We are very much Bible students of prophecy, are we not? We know the prophecies, we believe the prophecies, and we hold them to be true. And we've been preaching Christ's return now for decades. But notice what would happen in verse 3 through 5. Notice what he says. He says, but knowing this first, that scoffers will come when? In the last days. Walking according to their own lust. Now, what are these scoffers? Who are these scoffers? Are they atheists? Are they those who are skeptical of the Bible? Not at all. These are Christians inside God's church. How do I know that? Look in verse 4. And saying, where is the promise of His coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation. Now think about that for just a minute. They say, where is the promise of His coming? In other words, people that are skeptical of the Bible, atheists, have no thought of the second coming. They're not going to be talking about the second coming. But these are people who are Bible-believing, or solely, supposedly, Bible-believing Christians. And they begin to question the second coming of Christ. Now, let's put this into a little bit more modern perspective. There are people within God's church today who will say, yeah, we've been preaching for decades about the second coming of Jesus. We've been preaching for a long time that Jesus is going to come. I've heard all the sermons about the second coming of Jesus. I've heard all the signs of the times, and things just continue to roll on. You know, people told me when I graduated from high school, they said, hey, man, you don't have time to go to college because Jesus is coming. And they say, well, I went to college and Jesus didn't come. And then they said, people then told me, hey, man, don't get married because Jesus is going to come, right? And then they say, well, Jesus didn't come. And then they said, hey, man, don't have any kids because Jesus is going to come. And guess what? Jesus hasn't come. And so I've heard it all. I've been hearing for years people tell me, don't do this and don't do that because Jesus is coming. And they say, but Jesus hasn't come, and I'm tired of hearing those messages. You ever met somebody like that? Yeah, I have too. And you know what? Peter said that those people would rise in the last days. When he says scoffers would rise in the last days, when he uses the phrase the last days, what time period is he talking about? Ours. Ours. And do we see that people rising up, yes or no? People are rising up and saying, oh, I've heard this message all my life, and yet Jesus still hasn't come. And they go off and they live their lives for the world with one foot in the church and one foot in the world, saying, well, if Jesus really does, if it starts to get really close, then I'll just pull that foot out of the world and into the church. And friends, let me tell you, if we're caught in that circumstance, the foot that is in the world will not come into the church, but the one foot that is in the church will be swept out into the world. Christ calls us to live every day as if he was returning today. Yes or no? Now, keep reading. Verse 5. Watch this. It gets even better. For this they, the scoffers, willfully forget. Now, let me ask you something. If you willfully forget something, what does that mean? Does it mean that you have forgotten it on accident? No. If I willfully forget my wife's birthday, I've done it on purpose. I've willfully, of my own will, forgotten my wife's birthday. It wasn't an accident. So these people are intentionally forgetting something. What are they forgetting? Look at what it says. That by the word of God, the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of water and in the water, by which the world that was then existed perished, being flooded with water. But the heavens and the earth, which are now preserved by the same word, are reserved for fire until the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men. What is it that they forget? That by the word of God were the heavens made. Think about that for just a minute. If you willfully forget that by the word of God were the heavens made. What is that phrase? If you could put that phrase into one word, by the word of God were the heavens made, what would be that one word? Creation. Creation. What he's saying is that people living in the last days in God's church, that's the time that we're living in now, would forget that God created. He would forget that he created the world by his word. Now, let me ask you something. Have we been having and experiencing any problems with groups rising up in the church claiming that the world was not made by creation, but by evolution? Yes or no? Oh, yeah. It's been happening all around. And there are many today that are embracing that idea. Are you understanding me here? And Peter is the one that said that that would happen. Now, what is the problem? Some people say, well, it really doesn't make that big of a deal. What does it really matter if we believe in evolution or creation? Well, friends, this is the bottom line. If we forget that God had the power to create the world in 6 days by the power of His Word, then we forget His same power to recreate the human heart by His Word. Are you with me? Friends, we cannot afford to abandon the concept of creation, because if we forget how God created the world, we forget how He can recreate our unconsecrated hearts. And then we're doomed, you understand? And then once we stop believing that God can recreate our hearts, then we walk around like the scoffers and say, where is the promise of His coming? Then we start doubting the second coming, you see. Then we start doubting the Word of God, and before you know it, we doubt everything that we've ever stood for, and we're on our way out the church. So has our church, through this avenue, and not just creation, friends, it's not just about creation, but it's about all of our distinctive beliefs as Seventh-day Adventists. All of our distinctive beliefs that we hold dear as Seventh-day Adventists, are there scoffers rising up in the church today and saying, well, you know, I don't even know about this and I don't even know about that. Men who are popular speakers that are casting doubt on the things that we have held to for so long. And it's not about us holding on to things. If what we have held on to is not biblical, then we need to change it. It's not just about hanging on to tradition and the way we've always done it, the good old boys. It's not about that at all. But it's about clinging to what we know to be truth from the Word of God. And friends, we must hold on to the truth that has been established already. And we must not allow scoffers to rise up and say, hey, we don't need to believe those things anymore. We're more modern than that. We are contemporary. We are postmodern minds. Those things are primitive. It's not popular and acceptable in the world's eyes for us to preach these unpopular truths. Yes, truth has never been popular to the unconverted heart. And when a man preaches truth, it will stir up emotions and passions in the hearts of unconverted men and women. But if it be true from God's Word, then so be it. So be it. We must cling, friends, to the Word of God in these last days, or we will be deceived. So is there a great disappointment taking place in our church right now, yes or no? Listen, friends, Peter said it would happen. John, the Revelator, said it would happen in the Laodicean church, that these things would take place, and that Ellen White tells us that it would seem like the church would be about to fall, but God promises that He will carry it through. Amen? You see, friends, the things that are arising in our church ought not to bring discouragement to us. They ought to actually bring encouragement to us, not because they're not discouraging, but because we're told that they would happen before the end, and it means that we're all the more closer to the return of Christ. Amen. So friends, don't be discouraged by the negative things that happen in the church, although they can be discouraging, but don't become discouraged, because God's bitter disappointment will ultimately be turned into God's divine appointment. How many of you can say amen? Praise God for that. What God wants us to see is that we're missing the bigger picture. Look in verse 8. He says, but beloved, do not forget this one thing, that with the Lord one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as a day. The Lord is not slack concerning His promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. That is God's great desire, that all should come to repentance. That is one of the reasons that He's waiting so that all could come. But I want you to notice something, friends. Many times we use this verse, to say, well, the reason that the world keeps going on the way it does, the reason evil keeps getting greater, the reason that God is delayed and Jesus is not coming is because God is waiting for the lost to come to Him. No. I want you to notice this. Let's read the verse again. Verse 9. The Lord is not slack concerning His promise, as some count slackness, but as long-suffering toward who? Towards who? Does He say the world? Does He say the lost? It says He's long-suffering toward us, the church. The word long-suffering, if you just flip that around, means suffering long. He's suffering a long time. But He's suffering not because of the world, but because of us. Because He's not willing that any should perish, but that how many? All should come to repentance. In other words, the reason that the world goes on is because He's waiting on His people to wake up and recognize their mission of saving the lost, bringing the lost to Him. He's waiting, waiting, waiting. And friends, while we think that we're waiting on Him, He's actually waiting on us. There is a waiting time. Yes, indeed. We thought Jesus would come by now, and He has not. But there is a waiting time because He is waiting for us, this apparent delay. So what is it specifically that God is waiting for? We said He's waiting for us to wake up and recognize our mission. Well, maybe He's waiting for a few more signs of the times. Maybe He's waiting for some more tornadoes and earthquakes and tsunamis to gobble up and destroy, devour a couple hundred thousand more people. Maybe He's waiting for some more destruction to take place. Does God take pleasure in destruction, yes or no? Not in the slightest. Not in the slightest. He doesn't take pleasure in these things. Not in more signs of the times. Because since the 1700s, major signs have been fulfilled every century. Every sign of in the Bible, all the physical signs of natural disasters, we've seen them all. Notice this, Dr. Stephen Hawking, one of the most respected scientists in the world, notice what he said, AP World News, just a few years ago. He says this, "It is important for the human race to spread out into space for the survival of the species." Look at that. He says, life on Earth is at an ever-increasing risk of being wiped out by a disaster such as sudden global warming, nuclear war, a genetically engineered virus, or other dangers we have not yet thought of. I mean, think about this for just a minute. The most brilliant, one of the top three brilliant, most brilliant scientific minds in the world tells us that our only chance to survive as a human race is to find another planet like Earth and move everybody over there. Wow. Isn't that interesting? Notice what he says. He says, we won't find anywhere as nice as Earth unless we go to another star system. Well, Dr. Hawking, I would most definitely agree with that. And we are going to go to another star system, aren't we? We're going to go to the celestial city which Christ has prepared for those who love Him. Amen? And how many of you love Jesus today? We want to be a part of that holy city. But he tells us, he makes a statement that planet Earth doesn't have much time left. In fact, in another news article, he makes a statement that we probably only have less than 100 years left. Not even 100 years left that this planet can continue to sustain the abuse that humanity has brought upon it. Wow. So this is what science tells us. Science admits that we're headed towards destruction. They know it. What is God really waiting for? Maybe he's waiting on the Pope. Maybe he's sitting in heaven saying, hey, you know, I'm waiting for the Pope to pass the Sunday law. Now, I believe that the papacy will lead the world in establishing a Sunday law. Don't misunderstand. But is this what God is waiting for? Well, in 2009 and 2010, Pope Benedict, we know this, you know this is going to happen because of the prophecies of Revelation 13 and Revelation 17 and the book Great Controversy. But in 2009 and 10, Pope Benedict said, there is an urgent need of a true worldwide political authority. Such an authority would have to regulate the law and would need to be globally recognized. It would have to have the authority to enforce submission from all nations in its decisions. Think about that. It would have to have the authority to enforce submission from all nations in its decisions. Then in 2011, again, he called for a global authority with universal jurisdiction where each of the world's nations would transfer some of their power to a central authority that will ensure justice to the world. Now, which authority do you suppose he wants all the nations of the world to transfer some of theirs to? Of course, it's going to be them. Pope Francis, when he took office, has said the very same things already. He, in his opening speech, he talked about the veneration of Mary, he talked about Sunday worship, and he talked about the authority of the church, reaching out to other Protestants. And just last week, he had this huge meeting with Lutherans, and Lutherans are making the ready. They're in the process of making the transition to come back to the Roman Church, ecumenicism, and that's exactly what prophecy has told us would happen. Prophecy is being fulfilled right before our very eyes, brothers and sisters. Just a few days ago, October 26th of this year, the United States of 2013, USA Today writes this article, USA and mentions USA and Vatican must embrace, by Francis Rooney. He says, the United States and the Holy See remain two of the most significant institutions in world history. One, notice this, one a beacon of democracy and progress, the other a sanctum of faith and allegiance to timeless principles. What is the papacy's timeless principles? That they have authority over Scripture and et cetera, et cetera. Timeless principles of persecution. Notice this. Another spot in his article, he says this. No two sovereigns are more naturally aligned than the United States and the Holy See in the pursuit of diplomacy found on the core moral principles of the inalienable rights of man, his essential God-granted human dignity, and the right to all of religious freedom. Isn't that interesting, friends? Not the right to religious freedom as Protestants view it, that every man has a right to worship according to his own conscience, but the way that the Vatican sees it, which is coerced submission from all, and they have liberty to worship the Roman way. That's their definition of religious liberty. But this statement was made just a few days ago. Very, very interesting, friends. So is God sitting on his throne up in heaven, twiddling his thumbs, waiting for the Pope to say, oh, well, I guess I better get a move on? Is that what he's waiting on? No, friends. He's waiting on something else. And we're told specifically what that is. Romans chapter 8, and we're drawing to a climax here. Romans chapter 8 and verses 19 through 22. Romans 8, verse 19 and on. Notice this. We're going to start in verse 22. It says this. For we know... Let's start in verse 20. Forgive me. Verse 20. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it in hope, because the creation itself also will be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groans and labors with birth pangs together until now. What is Paul essentially saying here? He's saying this. Before I tell you, let me make a disclaimer. I'm not saying that creation has its own personality, like I believe in Mother Earth or something. Okay, I'm not saying that. But Paul kind of gives creation in this passage kind of its own person. He talks about it like a person. It says that he says that creation was subjected to futility. Now think about this very logically. It was subject to futility. What's futility? It's suffering, right? Pain, suffering. Not willingly, it didn't want to, but because of him who subjected it in what? In hope, Paul says. Well, what was the hope? Why was it subjected to futility? Because of the fall of who? Adam and Eve. Because of the fall of man, creation was willing to subject itself to the effects of sin because of hope. What hope was it? That man would one day be redeemed. Amen? Are you with me? So creation was willing to go through the brutal effects of sin so that humanity could be restored. Okay? That's what he's saying. And he says, because it will also be delivered from the bondage into the glorious liberty of the children of God. But notice verse 22. For we know that the whole creation groans and labors with birth pangs until now. What did Jesus say would happen in the very last days? Matthew 20, chapter 24, I believe it's verse 8. He says that all these are the beginning of sorrows or birth pangs. So what Paul's saying is that the world is buckling and groaning because it desires to be delivered. Are you with me? It wants to be delivered from the effects and the bondage of the futility of sin. So what is it? Why is it buckling and groaning? What's it waiting for? It's waiting for the deliverance, but what has to happen before the deliverance? Look in verse 19. This is incredible. It says, for the earnest expectation of the creation. This, in other words, he's saying creation is eagerly waits for the revealing of the sons of God. Think about that for just a minute. The creation is waiting for the revealing of the sons of God, because before humanity can be taken from this earth, His character must reveal the same character as Christ. Amen? And so the creation is saying, the creation, look, in these last days of Earth's history, we're seeing this groaning, this buckling, this engagement, this kind of rebellion against the effects of sin. And that's why we see the tsunamis and the hurricanes and the earthquakes and the tornadoes and the fires, because creation is saying, it's time. Listen, friends, it seems like the Pope knows what time it is. The papacy, nature, creation knows it's time for deliverance, for Jesus to come. It's been under the bondage of sin for 6,000 years. It knows that it's time. It seems to be that even science, the secular world, with Dr. Hawking and others who have made similar statements, they know it's the time. It seems like everyone knows it's time except the people of God. How ironic that the people who ought to be warning everyone else are the ones that are asleep, and everyone else knows it's time. It's time. We're done. We're finished. It's enough is enough. And God's people say, oh, well, we're gonna just enjoy the world a little bit more. We're just going to pursue our own desires a little bit more. We just got to get a little more money in the bank before we forsake all to follow Jesus. We just need a little bit bigger house. We just need to do a few more things in this life. Lord, don't come back because I want to get married. Lord, don't come back because I want to have children. Lord, don't come back because I want to join retirement. Friends, where do we draw the line? And we say, even so, come Lord Jesus. God is looking for a people who would actually want Him to come. God is waiting for a people who will say, yes, Jesus, we want you to come. We're waiting for you to come. Our hearts are breaking for you to come. And we are willing to give our hearts unconsecrated, unreservedly to you, totally consecrated and unreservedly to you. We're in an apparent delay. We're in a waiting time. We're in a waiting time, just like the disciples and just like the Advent believers. And the question that we need to ask ourselves is, what are we doing during the waiting time? I'll tell you what we ought to be doing. We ought to be doing the same things that the disciples and the Advent believers did during their waiting time. Yes or no? We ought to be crying out to have revival in our lives. We ought to be crying out to have characters that are like Jesus, full of love and compassion for the lost, full of love and compassion for His church, full of love and compassion for Him. We ought to have a refocused mission and realize that our priorities need to be readjusted and that we are personally accountable to God for the salvation of souls around us. We are accountable to be a part of sharing the gospel with the world. It is not some church program that's going to share the gospel with the world. It is not your pastor that's going to ultimately be the only one involved in sharing the gospel with the world. But it is going to be God's people going forth with full of love for Him and full of love for the lost who will proclaim that message to the world. We ought to be doing these things, humbling our hearts, true repentance, confessing our unbelief, praying for a fitness to share Christ, putting away all differences, putting away all desire for supremacy, coming close together in Christian fellowship, not having any more desire for worldly greatness, and letting Christ fill our hearts, the same experience that the disciples had before the outpouring of the Holy Spirit could take place in the early rain is the same experience that the disciples living in the last days, you and I, must experience before God would pour out the Spirit in the latter rain. Where are God's people? God is waiting on us to hasten the latter rain. Look in Peter. Look back in Peter there. 2 Peter 3, 2 Peter 3, verse 11 and 12, he says, therefore, since all these things will be dissolved, what manner of persons ought you to be in holy conduct and godliness? God's looking for godliness in His people. And that can only be wrought through Him doing it in us. We don't do it ourselves. He does it. But we are looking for and what? Hastening the coming of the day of God, because the heavens will be on fire and will melt with fervent heat. Jesus tells us, Peter tells us, that He is waiting on us to hasten the latter rain and the coming of Jesus. Did you know that we can hasten it? And when that happens, friends, the Holy Spirit, when God's people become serious enough about Him, He will pour out the Holy Spirit and latter rain power, and it will radically empower us to accomplish the mission that God has called us to do, which is to preach the gospel into all the world. And Matthew 24, verse 14, will be accomplished, and this gospel will go into all the world as a witness to all nations, and then the end shall come. Brothers and sisters, God is waiting for you and I. And when that happens, we go home. So if you see here, we have the same experience as the disciples and asking, is it the time? Experiencing a great disappointment, missing the bigger picture, but Jesus would reveal it to us. Realizing there's a mission to fulfill, going through a waiting time, truly searching the heart. And we're in the waiting time right now, you understand? We're still waiting. And we need to be searching our hearts and pleading with God to have revival. And the next step is going to be the latter rain being poured out, the mission accomplished, and then we go home. What is Jesus really waiting for? He's waiting with longing desire for the manifestation of himself in his church. And when the character of Christ will be perfectly reproduced in his people, then he will come to claim them as his own. Amen? Why are we looking up, or are we looking around? Are we looking up, and are our lives reflecting us looking up, waiting for Jesus to come? Or are we looking around at all the problems and the shortcomings that we see in the lives of others? You understand? Are we looking around? Are we looking and critically? Are we saying about certain leaders in the church, oh, well, they're not being faithful to God and blah, blah, blah. Are we looking around at others in our local church and saying, I don't know why this person... Are we looking around with critical attitudes? Are we looking up faithfully with the promises of God in our hands, saying, Lord Jesus, fill me with your Spirit. Lord Jesus, fill me with your love and your compassion. Forgive my heart. Change my life. And allow me to be one who lives totally sold out for you. Is that our experience? I want to close briefly with a story. A young man named Andre that I met in Ukraine. And this young man was an atheist, 22 years old. He came to my prophecy seminar, and he came every single night. His life was radically transformed because of the truths that he had heard, because he heard of a Jesus that loved him, a Jesus that had a plan for his life, a Jesus that wanted to change him and do great things in him and through him. And he accepted and embraced Jesus and his truth. And he said, I want to be a part of this great Advent movement prophesied about in the last days. And so he said, I want to be baptized. And we said, sure, brother, we'll baptize you. So the day came for the baptism, and he didn't show up. His parents told him that if he were to be baptized, they would disown him as their son. And they told him that if he was baptized anyway, not only would they disown him, but if he tried to come home, they said that they would kill him. They told him, he said, we'll kill you. And that actually happens in that country. It's happened before. He lost his job because of the Sabbath. They fired him and said, we need somebody that can work any day. He lost his job, lost his family. He said, I still want to be baptized. And then when the day of the baptism came, he didn't show up. And I thought, man, somebody got to this guy, but God wasn't going to give up. We prayed. He later called us and he said, I woke up to go to the baptism. And he said, and I felt strange and weak and lightheaded. He said, my heart was racing in a strange way. And he said, and I said, so I went to the hospital and they told me I have a major heart problem and I have to stay here for the surgeon to come. He says, but I want to be baptized. See, the devil took his job. He tried to take his family and he even tried to take his life. But God knew the heart of this young man. And this young man, he said, can I meet with you? Is there going to be another baptism? And I said, yes, there'll be another baptism next week. He said, can you meet me at such and such a day and time this week? I said, how are you going to get out of the hospital? They told him he couldn't leave. They put a guard at his door so he wouldn't leave. He says, don't worry about it. I'll meet you. That week, this is the time that I took this picture right here when we met. This is evidence that we met. I said, brother, how'd you get out of the hospital? He says, well, they had me on the second story, and the nurse wouldn't let me leave. He says, so I opened the window, and I jumped out the window, and I came to meet you. He says, I have to be baptized this weekend. I said, sure, let's do it. So I said, how are you going to get out? He says, don't worry about it. I'll take care of it. That Sabbath came, and there was that young man, and he was baptized. He jumped out of the window again to escape, to come and be baptized. And there he was. And his heart was so dedicated to Jesus. He says, if Jesus has given all so that I could live, how can I throw that away by not giving all in response to him? And friends, I would ask you today, if there are those who are willing to give up everything to follow Jesus, should we not be willing to give up everything to lead them to Jesus? How many of you want God to use you in these last days? How many of you want to say, Jesus, I need revival, I need renewal in my life, I need to refocus mission. Lord, I need to be personally involved in your work. We're personally accountable, and Jesus wants us all to have a place in his work. How many of you want to have that experience today? And say, Lord Jesus, bring revival to my heart and use me in your great work to proclaim your soon return to every person that I can. Is that your desire today? Friends, God bless you, and may God use you as you have chosen. Let us all be ready. Let us all be found faithful on that day when our Savior returns. Amen. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for this opportunity, and we pray that your blessing would be with us, that you would draw close to our hearts, and that you would accomplish this thing in your people, which you have promised. Bring revival, bring the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, and let us go forth to labor for you. And may the Spirit of God lead us all the way home, we pray, into your arms. We ask in Jesus' name, amen.